Ever stood in an empty room and felt you weren't alone? Psychic investigator Andy Matthews has.
Short of having an apparition walk through a wall and shake your hand, this is as close as you're going to get.
And he's not alone.
I was born on Halloween, just before midnight, and I am the seventh daughter of a seventh daughter.
A medieval tower house at the heart of a town steeped in military history. Some say a benign spirit haunts this place. Others sense a darker presence.
I understand your pain, sir.
This is a big one for us tonight. Will it work? That's anyone's guess.
Something's down there.
This is somebody hearing what I hear. It's absolutely phenomenal.
There's something banging around somewhere.
There we go, yes.
They believe. The question is to you.
This investigation is keeping me close to Belfast. In fact, the area we're in now is almost regarded as a suburb these days. But this town was very powerful and important long before Belfast even got going. Carrickfergus is dominated by this magnificent castle, but I'm not here for the castle. It does, however, play a very important part in the place I'm investigating, right across the road.
Since its foundation in the Middle Ages, many ghost stories have been told in Carrickfergus. But the most famous is the 19th century tale of Buttoncap the soldier and his mistress Maud, whose spirit is said to haunt the old Norman tower house near the castle, a building now owned by Derek and Maureen Fallis.
Andy Matthews, Maureen, how are you? So this is the infamous Dobbins. So what about the place itself? Has it always been a hotel?
Well, it was an inn in about 1600, as reported in Miskimmon's History of Ireland.
Has it been other things in the past?
It's had quite a checkered past. It's been an armoury, it has been a jail.
Really?
Right the way back in time. So it's changed quite a lot since its original...
Police station, one stage, yes.
Obviously you've got Carrickfergus Castle just over the way there. Does that date at the same time as this building?
Well, it's slightly younger than the castle in that the John de Courcy, who finished the building there, granted the lands here to one of his lieutenants, the Dobbin, and he built his castle here, so slightly after the castle.
So you've got many, many, many years of history here, yes. So it must have some ghost stories attached to it.
Oh, very much so. We have our own personal ghost called Maud, but the best person that you need to talk to is Karen. She can tell you all about the sightings of Maud.
Karen's the expert.
She is.
In the 6 years that she's worked here, Karen Smith believes she's encountered the hotel's resident spirit more than once.
Now, the infamous one is Maud, and I believe you've had some experiences.
Well, I've had a few experiences, yes.
Like what?
I've had a few experiences in the bar when my apron's been tugged, things like that. And I've had a few experiences in the kitchen, just in there behind you.
Oh, right. Okay.
Yeah.
Should we go have a look?
Yes, we'll have a look. Pots and pans have fallen off the shelves, you know, these wee hooks here now. As you can see there, they're little hooks,
uh-huh.
So you have to lift the pot or the utensils to come off. They've actually fallen off when nobody's been standing there. On up in here now, you know, there's been food was actually sitting there and it came right off the whole shelf and it was all over the floor. There's been flour has been knocked over, it went everywhere.
So you've got a lot of poltergeist activity that's happening
here. I know now that Maud's favourite place would be upstairs on the first floor.
The first floor?
The first floor.
Are you okay to go up there?
Well, I'm a bit nervous. I'm not too keen upstairs.
Why are you a bit
pushed? I don't like upstairs.
Is it a feeling that you get?
It's a bad feeling I get any time I go upstairs. Being watched is the word.
Right. Do you want me to go first?
Yes.
Apparently, Maud's presence is strongest in room 21.
How do you feel?
Not nice. It's not nice.
Did you get a sense of Maud up here?
Yes. Right. The sense of Maud in the room now, yes.
And despite her being quite a friendly spirit, it does unnerve you still.
It's still unnerved.
Karen's reaction seems at odds with the benign reputation of Dobbins' ghost. Perhaps Maud, if this is Maud, is not as friendly as she's made out.
I let you go in there. I don't like in there at all.
Don't like it?
No. I don't like that bathroom at all.
I must admit, there is a kind of a dense atmosphere down there.
It
makes you feel
nice.
Woozy.
Yeah, that's how I feel.
Karen, you seem to be back against the wall. Is it that strong for you?
It is. It's very strong for me. Very strong, yes.
You won't come any further?
No. And I'm perfectly fine anywhere else in the hotel. But in here, it's just... No. It's as if I'm being told, don't come any further. Just stay where you are.
You feel as though you're not welcome?
No. Definitely not.
There is a feeling up there. It's claustrophobic. It's very... The atmosphere is very dense, and especially in room 21. To be alone up there, I think, would unnerve anybody. I don't care how big, tall, strong, tough you are. Everybody's going to feel that kind of strange sense of being watched. Karen, who do you think Maud was? In your opinion?
In my opinion, I think Maud was married to someone that lived here. And she had an affair with Buttoncup, the castle. Very much in love, I think. Unfortunately, they got found out, and she took her own life.
It seems that almost everyone in Carrickfergus has their own take on the legend of Maud and Buttoncup.
Have you ever had any experiences in there yourself?
After about 6 pints, on.
Yes, I've heard that they do have a ghost in the bedrooms. Something to do with the bedrooms.
Buttoncup.
And who's the lady?
Oh, don't know who the lady is.
So what story have you heard?
He dollars about under that wee tunnel from here to the castle, his head on his arm.
Do you believe in ghosts yourself?
Yes.
Yeah, I bet.
I do.
Well, I had an aunt who used to work here for a long time.
Did she see the ghost of Maud, the woman?
Yes.
Ah.
She did.
To get a clearer sense of the story's origins, Andy's arranged to meet local expert Doreen Corcoran at Carrickfergus Museum.
Now, this local legend of Maud and Buttoncup...
I don't know much about Maud, but Buttoncup, I grew up with the story of Buttoncup, and he certainly existed. He was an ensign in the army, which is where the name comes from. Ensigns wore round pillbox hats with a button on the top, and he had a liaison with an officer's wife. The husband found out, and there was an unfortunate fracas in which the ensign was killed. And that was why his ghost then haunts the castle, still loving the lady, but dying for...
So that is fact, then? That is fact that...
Well, the fact is that there was an ensign and that there was difficulty with an officer's wife, and certainly that the guns were fired.
So there we have the castle, there we have the church. Where were Dobbins Inn?
And Dobbins is one of these tower houses here.
One of these here.
There's a slightly later map which has the marking on it, Dobbins, and it's spelled D-O-B-Y-N-S.
So, like the castle, Dobbins has been at the heart of Carrickfergus since the town's foundation.
Anything of importance, whether in the way of trade or social activities, would have been there. They would have been in the middle. They were people of consequence.
Today is Marion Goodfellow's first visit to Carrickfergus.
I'm a medium. It's really mediator. I'm a mediator between this world and spirit world.
Marion's initial impression of a location is crucial to her role as a medium. Insisting on a clean slate, she's come here knowing nothing of the town, its history, or the alleged ghost of Dobbins Inn. Once inside, it's not long before she senses there's more to this hotel than meets the eye.
There's a lot more going on underneath. than we actually realise. This, I think, either subterranean cellar or something. When I sense that there's something underneath me, it's almost as if my feet drop away from me. Like I could be up to my knees or even up to my waist. It's a sensation, it's strange. Over the years, I've got quite good at detecting tunnels and things like that. So I think there's something definitely going on underneath.
With this being a coastal town, there's always the stories of smugglers and all this shenanigans going on. Do you have any knowledge of any tunnels that went from Dobbins Inn maybe to the castle?
I don't have any knowledge, but I have lots and lots of tales and stories, because this is common, not just for coastal towns. Any ancient town seems to have stories of tunnels. And I think people like mystery and they like to be intrigued. So where you have a very old building and you have another very old building, over the years people will think, ha-ha, something funny went on, so they had a tunnel. Either it was someone had a mistress in another building, or it was people planning rebellion.
Comes right across.
Straight across and up there.
Yeah.
Barely 100 yards apart and built within decades of one another, the castle and Dobbins Inn could have had a tunnel running between them. Marion certainly feels a strong connection between the two buildings. Could this connection have anything to do with the tragic tale of the soldier and the officer's wife? Andy takes Marion back to Dobbins to see if she can get a sense of Maud, or any presence, on the way up to room 21.
There's just a mishmash of energies. But on here I have a lady. She's shushing me away. Shush. Go away. Like that. As if I'm not allowed here.
Uh-huh, okay.
I'm not allowed up here. That's all I'm feeling with her, but it is definitely a lady. Different sensation. This is a bit scary, this energy. This would make people fill people with dread. Do you understand? It's sort of, ooh,
okay.
Just heavy. Different energy, gentleman's energy, I feel. But I feel like a choking sensation. All I can tell you is what I'm feeling.
Right.
Perhaps somebody hung themselves here, or somebody was strangled here.
People that have stayed in this room have had some very similar experiences. Just feeling that they don't want to go. They don't want to come in here.
Yeah.
Especially Karen, who works here. You know, she just stood here by the wall and just would not move. She wouldn't go any further into the room. So we don't know who it is, what it is.
Why it's here.
It's just a feeling.
I immediately said, Maud, I think that's the lady. Shoo, shoo, shoo.
Yeah.
Shoo, shoo. Get away. Go away. But I feel masculine in here. I've got a middle-aged male. Mid to late 50s. Very depressed feeling. An unhappy feeling around him.
Far from the blithe spirit of a lady suggested by local folklore, the energy sensed by Andy and Marion appears malevolent and male. Later that evening, the paranormal study and investigation team arrive to set up their equipment. If there is a ghost at Dobbins Inn, male or female, they aim to find it.
As a team, we've always kept the mediumship spiritual side completely separate to the investigative side, with the equipment, technology and the science of it. As an investigator, I'm extremely sceptical, and you have to be.
I think bringing the technical side and the scientific side into what myself and Marion do is absolutely paramount. We can all walk into a haunted house and say, oh, I feel this, I feel that. But to a viewer or to anybody looking on, it could be anything. But to capture it scientifically is really the nuts and bolts of what I'm trying to do and the work that Marion and I are trying to achieve.
Given the potent atmosphere of Room 21, the team will be focusing most of their efforts there. On Andy's advice, however, the investigation won't be limited to the first floor.
The kitchen's had a lot of psychokinetic energy. Knives, cutlery, metal objects, even pens throw themselves across the room. We've got the place wired for sound. We've also got an infrared camera up there. It's dark, the chef's gone home. So all we can do now is wait. I used to get scared in the early days, but the more you do this, the fear factor is replaced by fascination. But, you know, I'm no fool. You know, we're dealing with things we don't know and we can't explain. So, you know, rather than stomp around believing I'm untouchable, I've got a sense of respect for what I'm trying to study. So, yeah, I always tread with a bit of caution. So, yeah, I do get on nerves from time to time.
With their cameras monitoring the kitchen, the team is keen to delve further into Marion's renowned psychic ability. According to paranormal science, all living things emit an aura of invisible radiation.
Many believe that we have an aura around us, like an electrical field, which obviously we can't see, but the guys have got hold of an aura camera, which apparently can photograph people's auras. So they're going to try it, obviously, with the medium, because when a medium interacts with a spirit, then an aura should change.
The team is hoping to record evidence of something Marion has always claimed but never been able to prove scientifically, her clairvoyance. Tony, the PSI's resident skeptic, will be in charge of the experiment.
We're going to seat Marion down and take some shots. Hopefully before, obviously, she goes into trance. Take some shots as she goes into trance, during trance and afterwards as well, just to see if there's anything, not necessarily any spirits drawn forward, but in her change in mood as well, to see if there's any differences in the shots. I don't hold out high hopes for it. I expect to get the same results consistently the whole way through in the same sort of colour patterns.
Using nothing more than a modified instant camera and regular film, Tony will take two photographs at a time as Marion slips into a trance, then returns to normal consciousness. In theory, with no change in the light or temperature of the room, all the photographs should be identical.
Come on then, let's have a look.
Let's have a look. These two photographs were taken just before when you were in a sort of happy, relaxed mood. These two next two photographs here are just as you were getting into trance. As you can see, the colour's completely changed.
Mm-hmm. Brighter, lighter.
Both completely changed.
Mm. That's...
I didn't think there would be a change. I honestly didn't. Let's have a look at the others.
Let's have a look. Okay.
That's the state I was trying to tell you I get myself. I totally disappear. My energy isn't there anymore. The spiritual energy has completely taken over.
That's amazing.
This is the first time ever I've actually seen that happen. Coming back.
So you can see the comparison between these two, exactly the same colour.
So one's going down,
one's coming and one's going out. Mm. Being totally sceptical, I'm amazed at the pattern, you know.
This bit where I've disappeared, well, how do you explain that, Tony? Huh? How do you explain it? Explain it. Yeah, where have I gone, Tony?
I don't have an explanation for that.
Later, once the team have wired Room 21, Andy and Marion can attempt direct contact with whatever spirit may be present.
Are there any disembodied spirits present within this room? Yes.
I've got the sensation in my throat again.
Tony has a thermal camera trained on Marion to record any changes in her body temperature. Tonight, the team are hoping to achieve an extraordinary first for paranormal investigation.
Throughout our research as a team, we've had some results with interest in EVP, electronic voice phenomena.
So what we're trying to achieve is, rather than just hearing these voices coming through, we would like to try and create, if you like, a live conversation.
Next door in room 22, Mark is monitoring Andy and Marion's conversation. If he can pick up and interpret any unexplained voice phenomena, he'll feed the word straight back to Darren in room 21. The team believe that this could lead to a live two-way conversation with the spirit world.
This is like a moon landing, because if this comes off, it's going to be something that's never been done, it's never been attempted before, as far as to my knowledge, and it's certainly never been achieved.
So this is a big one for us tonight. Will it work? That's anyone's guess.
Is this the female known as Maud?
It's the man.
It appears they've now made contact with the sinister male presence in the room.
Were you shot, sir? Did you shoot somebody?
I got something that sounds like, please stop.
Right after where he asked where he got shot. Please stop.
I understand your pain, sir. I can feel it. You don't need to be here. You don't need to be here, sir.
Right, when she says you don't have to be here, it's something like they won't let me, or they don't love me, or something like that.
They don't love me, or they won't let me.
I've come to set you free.
Marion sees herself as a spiritual conduit, a guide leading trapped souls to freedom. But the male presence she senses in the room seems reluctant to depart.
Can you reach out across the void and grasp the hand of those that love you? All you need do is grasp that hand.
Carry me.
Will you carry me?
You don't need to be carried. All you need to do is reach out. Hold on tight. Hold on really tight. Now go with him. God's sake.
There was something come through there.
Is there anybody else here?
Jesus, that was a... It's a woman, right?
Is your name Maud? Maud, are you happy here?
If this is what it appears to be, this has got to be the first time ever that live communication between a medium and something possibly paranormal has ever happened.
That is something else.
That was just like a two-way conversation, wasn't it? Everything he's analysing and checking. But it seems to be at this point in time that, you know, we've got proof. We've got proof.
With the dark presence moved on, it would seem that Maud has reasserted herself. But it will take hours to analyse the audio data. In the meantime, Andy's hoping the night's events have brought peace to at least one individual at the hotel.
Well, at the beginning of this investigation, Karen, who works here, was terrified of going into room 21. Now, Marion's in there with her now, trying to talk her through her fears. We did some kind of clearance in there last night, so hopefully the atmosphere in there would have lifted.
There are several energies around the place, but there is absolutely nothing to fear. There's nothing horrible here. Absolutely nothing horrible
here. I think that's what a lot of us were more frightened of in here, you know, of something evil and horrible and things, you know.
Yeah, well, when I first came in, it was really, really heavy. Mm-hmm. The feeling, I felt like I was being throttled. Mm-hmm. But we think we've moved this energy on.
Right.
this heavy energy shouldn't actually be felt here anymore.
Okay.
But Maud will be. And I hope now you know that she won't hurt you. Do you feel any different this morning?
A little bit different now. I got dizzy again as soon as I came in. But it seems quite flowery, like
a lighter energy.
Yes.
Mark has now analysed and clarified all the audio evidence, creating a complete record of Marion and Andy's apparent two-way conversation with the spirit of Room 21. The results, even compared to the live feedback, are extraordinary.
I'm addressing the male presence in this room. Do you want to talk to us? Do you want to talk to Marion?
Will you leave?
Try it again. I didn't quite get it.
You want to talk to Marion?
Leave me.
Leave me. And this is exactly the conversation as it happened.
You want to talk to us? You want to talk to Marion?
Leave me.
Not only are the voices there, but the voices and what we think they're saying are relevant to the conversation.
Yeah. So we have a chance to help you. You know what I'm saying? Yes, just he understands what I'm trying to do. Do you not want to know?
Do you understand? It's just
to help you. You know what I'm saying? Yes, he understands what I'm trying to do.
I'm really baffled. I'm not baffled, I'm excited, but it's like finding the Holy Grail. This, I mean, short of having an apparition walk through a wall and shake your hand, this is as close as you're going to get.
Are you in pain?
Run it again.
Sounds like, will you carry me home?
I think it says with you. You listen. Listen again. With you.
Yeah.
It's with you. Will you carry me with you?
Are you in pain?
Can you carry me?
It's... For me, this is my whole life's work. This is somebody hearing what I hear. And it's just phenomenal. It's absolutely phenomenal.
I have a little something here. There's a voice, and then there's you. You say, don't turn back for God's sake.
There's the way out to the light, yeah.
There's another voice. It's okay.
We'll run it back.
It's okay.
Who said that? It's a girl.
That sounds like a female to me. And then pretty soon after that, you pick up a... Are you all right?
It's okay.
I've been doing this for a long, long time, and there's always been that goal to try and capture scientific proof of the existence of ghosts and an afterlife. And in this place, this week, I think we've done it.
It seems there was a much darker presence at Dobbins Inn than the friendly ghost of Maud. Before setting it free, Andy and Marion believe they achieved something unprecedented. A live, two-way conversation with the spirit world. The question is, do you?